Hey guys, welcome to part 7 of Create Your Own Webshop with ESP.net. In today's lesson, we will be building a shopping cart page. A shopping cart is frequently used to allow a user a quick overview of all items which he or she has ordered from an online store. So in this page, we can order new items from the shop, which will then be displayed on the page. We can update a quantity of a selected item, and we can also delete items from the cart altogether. A quick disclaimer before we get started. There have been several persons who have asked me if I could implement a PayPal checkout system in this lesson. And the answer is yes, we certainly can. As you can see, I have a PayPal checkout button over here, which when clicked redirects me to the PayPal page, on which we can see that the total amounts on both our shopping cart page and the PayPal page match. However, we will not be covering this subject in this lesson. There are a few reasons for this, chief among them being that to do this, we will need our own PayPal account, basic knowledge of how PayPal works, and last but not least, an online testing environment. PayPal does not allow testing on local host websites, so you'll need an online testing environment, and I'm pretty sure most of us would rather keep to testing on local host. It is an interesting subject, however, and that's why I've created an optional video about how I've made this PayPal form. There is a link in the description below this video, so if you're interested in learning more about PayPal checkout, be sure to watch this video. But once again, if you're just here for the course and are not interested in PayPal, you can skip that video altogether. Alright, let's get started. Open up Visual Studio and open the website which we have been creating in our previous lessons. Alternatively, if you're just joining us today, you can download and open the starter pack from the description below this video. We're going to start by expanding the cart model class. So in the appcode/models, open the cart model file. We're going to add 4 new methods to this class. I'll just write down the method signatures for now. So the first method will return a list of cart objects and it's called getOrdersInCart, with a string called UserID for input. This method will retrieve all items within the current user's shopping cart. The next method will return an integer value and will be called getAmountOfOrders with a string UserID as well. This method will return the total amount of items in the shopping cart. Next up is a void method called updateQuantity. Use an integer ID and an integer quantity for input. This method will update a quantity of a selected product in the shopping cart. And then last but not least, we have another void method called markOrdersAsPaid, which has a list of cart objects as input. This method will mark all the items in the shopping cart as paid as soon as the user has completed his transaction. Let's start by working on the getOrdersInCart method. First things first, we'll need a connection to the database, so create a new garage entity object like this. Add a new list object containing cart object called orders and type down the following query. We need to get the items of the current user, so make sure that the client ID equals our user ID input. And the object must also not be paid for yet, so the is in cart boolean needs to be set to true. will order the objects by the date on which they were purchased. And then we return this result as a list by calling the toList method. And return the orders object. That's all we need to retrieve all objects, current objects in the shopping cart. Next up is the getAmountOfOrders method. We want this method to retrieve the total number of items in the cart. So for example, if a user has ordered two engine parts and one fan, then I want this method to return the number 3. Open a try-catch statement and have the catch statement return 0. Then within the try brackets, we'll need another connection to the database, so add another garage entities object. Create a new integer object called amount. We can copy and paste these 3 lines of code. They're exactly the same. And then select x dot oops x dot amount close brackets dot sum will return the sum of the amount fields and return your amount object. Moving on to update quantity. So once again, garage entities object, create a cart object and fill it with database data by typing in db.cards.find with the ID parameter for input and then set the amount of the cart object to your quantity input object. And call the db.saveChanges method to persist your changes to the database. And then last but not least, a user has paid, so we'll want to mark all the objects in the cart as paid for. Do a check to see if our input is not null. And then for each cart within our input list, perform the following code. There we go. And don't forget to persist the changes to the database. There we go. That should last our model throughout this entire lesson. Now let's get working on the shopping cart page. In your Pages folder, add a new webform and call it shopping cart. Don't forget about the master page. And within the second content placeholder, add a ESP panel and set its ID to panel shopping cart. Set the runNet property to server and close it. We will use this panel to display our dynamically generated cart objects upon. Underneath the panel, add an HTML table. We'll use this table to display our total amounts, value added tax, shipping costs, etc. Add a row with 2 columns. In the first column, add a bold tag. And between those bold tags, type in total equals. In the second column, add an ESP literal. Set its ID to LIT total. Its run add property to server. And its text property to null. And close the literal. Now copy and paste that row 3 times, so that we have a total of 4 rows with 2 columns each, and then modify the values like this. Let's set shipping costs to £15. Replace this literal by LIT VET. And at the bottom, total amount and literal ID set to lit total amount. There we go. Below that row, add another table row, but this time with only one column. We will be using this column for our continue shopping and our continue to checkout buttons. So just write down the code that I write here. There we go, that should do it for the HTML for this page. You might have noticed that we have set the postback URL of button checkout to a page which does not exist yet. Do not worry about this, we will create this page in a little while. For now, let's get working on the code behind of this page. The first thing which we need to do is get the ID of the currently logged in user and display all of that user's products in the shopping cart on this page. So to get the ID, add a new string called user ID and fill it with user.identity.getUserID. And to call this method, we will need to type in using Microsoft .esp.net.identity at the top of the class. Next, call the method getPurchases in cart with the user ID parameter for input. We haven't created this method yet, so let's let Visual Studio automatically generate it. You can do this easily by selecting the method and hitting Control and dot at the same time, and select the generate method stop. Within the new method, create a new cart model object and a double called subtotal, which is set to 0. We will use this double to add each total amount of each product type within the shopping cart. Next, create a new list of cart objects and call it purchased list. And fill it with the model.getOrdersInCart method which we've created at the beginning of this lesson. And use the user ID as input. Next, create another empty method called create shop table and use your purchase list as input. We will use this method to generate HTML for each cart object found in our purchase list. We're also going to do something interesting with this method. Within the input parameters, we are going to add the out keyword and add the double subtotal within the input. I believe you haven't used an out parameter yet, so let me quickly explain what it does. Basically, it allows the createShopTable method to return a second return value. As you are probably aware, a method can return only one return value, be it a string, integer, perhaps a collection of objects. It can return anything, but a method can only return one type of thing. Using out parameters, we can return multiple return values using the same method. I will explain how this works in a little while, but for now we are going to complete this method before we start working on the createShopTable method. Now let's add the total amount values to this web page. Add another double called VAT, which stands for value added taxes, and set this value to subtitle multiplied by 21%, which is the basic tax rate in my country. You can replace this by any value which you like. Then we'll create another double, let's call it total amount, which will display the total of all amounts, which is the subtitle, subtotal, plus value added taxes, plus shipping costs, which value £15. There we go. Now let's display those values on the web page. Whoops, I made a small error here. We can remove the double keyword after the out statement. So that's create shop table with purchase list, comma, out subtotal. Hit the control and dot keys at the same time to quickly generate the method stub for create shop table. Before we start working on this method, we're going to take a quick look at the page that we're going to be building. So over here we have our shopping cart. I currently have three types of items in my cart, so the page generates three HTML tables for me. So each of these lines is actually an HTML table with two rows and four columns each. Take a look at this simple paint sketch for reference. So every table has an image view, which takes up the height of two entire rows. To the right of that, we have three title cells and three content cells for respectively unit price, quantity and the item total, along with a link in the final column of the table, which contains a delete link, which allows us to remove unwanted products from the shopping cart. At the bottom of the page, we have some totals. So we have the total amount without value added taxes, the value added tax, the shipping costs, and the total amount to be paid. So that's the theory. Now let's start writing this in code behind. So back in Visual Studio, place your cursor between the create shop table brackets and write down the following code. Start by declaring the subtotal value, which is an out parameter, as a new double so that we can work with it. Next, call for each method on each cart object within the purchase list. We will first need to retrieve the data about the current cart in the list from the database so that we can fill our shopping cart list with relevant data. So first, outside of the for each brackets, call a product model and call it model. Then within the for each brackets, type in product product equals model dot get products and use the cart.product ID, which is the foreign key to the products table, as an input parameter. We're going to fast forward a bit here, since this is a pretty long method. Just write down the code which I write. I will explain the more interesting lines in a few moments. There we go. That should do it. Like I said, it's pretty long with it, so be sure to pause and rewind the video as often as is necessary until you have the entire method written down correctly. So, starting from the top, let's discuss some of the more interesting lines of code. Not much to say about the button image. We simply set its image URL and its postback URL by using the data found within the cart object. Link delete is a bit more interesting. When we click this link, the user gets redirected to this same shopping cart page. If we post back to this page and a product ID gets found in the URL, they will know that we'll need to delete this item from the shopping cart. It's also interesting to note here is the ID parameter. Since we're working with dynamically generated controls, we will need some sort of identifier to access this control later in our code. That's why we use the ID parameter. So the ID for product 18 would be del 18, the ID for product 20 would be del 20, and so on and so on. We add an onClick event and set it to the delete item event. We have not created this event yet, so select it and hit Ctrl and dot at the same time to generate the method stub. We'll create the event in a little while. Also notice that when dynamically adding events, we do not need to add parentheses after the method names. Just something which I find interesting and is also a common cause for rookie mistakes. Moving on to the quantity drop-down list. We first create an array of integers numbering 1 through 20. We then create a new drop-down list control and set its data source to our integer array. The auto postback parameter is set to true. This makes sure that whenever a new value is selected in a drop-down list, the page will refresh itself and will recalculate the total amounts depending on what quantity value was selected in a drop-down list. You may have noticed that we have set both the ID parameter of DDL amount and link delete to the ID property of the cart object. Normally speaking, when you have two controls on the same page with the same ID, your page will crash and generate an exception. That's why we have added the DEL prefix to the cart.id property, so that the code generates two separate IDs. Don't forget to call the DataBind method when working with dynamically generated data sources. Also take note, we add another event on line 77. We call a selected index changed event with a method which we have yet to create. So once again, select the method, hit Ctrl and dot at the same time, and generate a method stub for this event. We'll create that one as well in a little while. There's not a lot to say about the HTML table code. This code simply generates a HTML table with two rows and six columns. We then add the cells to the rows, the rows get added to the table, and the table gets appended to the static panel which we've added in the view of this web page. Line 130 sets the value of the out parameter subtotal. Notice how we do not need to add a return statement to use this value outside of the method. That's what the out keyword is for. Last but not least, on line 134, we add a session variable, which is specific to the current user, which contains the current user's shopping cart. We will later use this session variable to determine whether the projects in the cart have already been paid for or not. That should take care of the basic HTML. Now let's add some functionality to this page by adding methods for whenever the quantity gets updated or whenever a delete link gets clicked. Let's start by working on the selected index changed method. Remove the throw new not implemented exception and type in the following code. The first thing which we need to do is figure out which drop-down list has had its value updated. To do this, create a new drop-down list object, call it selected list, and set its value equal to the sender object, convert it to a drop-down list. This will provide us with all information which we need. Next, we will need the ID of the cart object, as well as its new quantity value. Getting the quantity is easy. Type in int quantity equals convert to int 32 selected list dot selected value. Getting the ID of the cart is a bit tricky, but not impossible. Remember, on line 72, we set the ID of the dynamic drop-down list to whatever cart ID was currently being processed. So, to get the cart ID, we can simply type in int cart ID equals convert to int 32 selected list dot ID. There we go. That should also explain why we use the cart IDs for the names of our drop-down list. Now that we have both values, we can update the data in the database. Create a new cart model object and use it to call the update quantity method which we've created earlier and use the cart ID and quantity parameters as input. Last but not least, refresh the page so that the item is removed from both the database and the web page as well. There we go, that is all there is to it. Now let's do the same for the delete item method. The methods are very much alike. We first need to figure out which link button was pressed. So create a new link button object called selected link and set its value equal to the sender object, convert it to a link button. The only real difference between both methods is that the ID of the selected link is not set to the ID of the cart object, but to del appended to the cart ID. So we'll first need to remove that prefix. Now that we have finished working on the shopping cart page, it's time to make a few changes to the master page as well. Specifically, I want a user to be able to access his or her shopping cart by clicking on his or her user's name in the top right corner of the screen. I also want to display the total amount of items in that user's cart to the right of his username. So within Visual Studio, open your master page. And in the source view, look for the lit status literal. And replace the literal by a hyperlink. You can leave the name as is, but add a navigate URL property. And set it to your newly created pages/shoppingcart.espx. There we go. Then go to your code behind. And between the if user is authenticated brackets, add the following code. There we go. We're making real progress now. Let's add a bit of security, so only logged in users can access this page. If you remember, in a previous lesson we protected certain parts of our website using web.config file. And today we're going to do the same thing. So open up your web.config. And look where the location path equals yada 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 line start. We can reuse most of this. So copy and paste one of the location sections and change the location path to pages/shopping carts. Remove all lines except for deny users and set its value to a question mark. This will grant access to all users except those who are not logged in. Another thing which we need to do is add a bit of CSS styling. So open your styles/style sheet folder. I will never be able to pronounce that correctly. And at the bottom of the page, add the following CSS code. Okay, that should do it. Let's run our page to see if everything's working. So we can access the shopping cart page by clicking on our username. And that looks pretty good actually. Let's see if our events work. Yep, they seem to be working. Splendid! Now all that we have to do left is provide a page that will handle our checkout. Double check your shopping cart page to see what you set your postback URL of your button checkout to. I set mine to success, so within the pages folder, add a new web form and give it their fitting name, which is success in this case. This is the page that the user is going to see after he pays for his or her products. So you can put a small thank you or success message here. Feel free to put in anything, let your imagination run wild. And now all that we need to do is provide the code behind. Do keep in mind that this is just a very, very simple example, which exists solely for the purpose of presentation. Do not, and I repeat, do not use these lines of code which you're about to see in a real-world application. We're not paying any attention to security here at all, we're just providing a simple abstract example. Having said that, just write down the code that I write here. There we go, that should do it. Now basically what this does is that whenever a user reaches this page, all shopping cart items which are currently stored in his or her session are loaded, and their isInCart property is set to false, which in this example would mark them as being paid for. Once again, this is a very simple example, only demonstration purposes, so do not use it in a real webshop unless you feel like giving stuff away for free. So let's perform a final check to see if everything's working. So we got some items in our cart. Let's try heading over to the navigation page. And as you can see, all items have been removed from the cart. They are now. So that concludes today's lesson. As mentioned at the beginning of this video, if you're interested in learning more about checkout security, which I strongly recommend, and want to learn more about checking out with PayPal, be sure to check out the optional video about checking out with PayPal. You can find the link to it in the description below this video. If you can't find the link yet, don't worry, that means that the video has not yet been uploaded, but it will be up soon. If you have any further questions, feel free to ask me them in the comment section below, or take a look at our forums. There's a link in the description. Any question which you may have might already be answered there. As always, thank you for watching, I hope you found this lesson useful, and I hope to see you again in our next and final lesson, in which you'll learn more about reporting using Google Charts.